Bibles to John chapter 20. John chapter 20. We're in a short series of topical messages, which is unusual, as you may know, for me to preach. But there's a method to the madness, if you're wondering about it. You say, Pastor, when are we going to be in a series again? We're going to begin a series in Romans right at the end of the summer. And the reason for that is there are so many interruptions, like teen camp and so forth. I don't want to get into a series and then miss a couple services that would, you know, make it so that it's so disjointed that no one knows really what's going on as we preach through Romans. I'm looking forward to that. And I trust that you will be, as you know that we're going to be in Romans, that you'll be reading, praying, and studying in the letter of Paul to the church at Rome, of course, by the Holy Spirit of God. And as you're preparing your heart for that, we trust that God's going to do some great works. There are just so many foundational doctrinal things that I guess we actually build on the foundation. Our foundation, of course, is our salvation. The foundation of the church is Christ as the cornerstone, the apostles and prophets, which is the Word of God, is our foundation. We're built up on it. But Hebrews chapter 6 tells us that we are to leave the foundational elements or foundational truths, not to go away from them, but to go beyond those things into spiritual maturity. And I believe that Romans is one of those keys as a believer to really locking down and understanding doctrinal truth, important doctrinal truth about God, that'll really help you to move on in your faith to a place of deeper understanding, of greater spiritual growth. Believer, I want to tell you something. You ought to know that you've grown. In other words, you ought to look back and think, man, when I first got saved, boy, I really grew. You ought to be thinking about, man, last week has been a growing time for me. Last month has been a growing time for me. You ought to be growing as a Christian. And wherever you're at in your stages of growth, you ought to be ready to do that. And you ought to be growing both in experience and responding by the Spirit of God to the experience and learning patience. That ought to be an area of growth in your life, but you ought to be growing doctrinally as well. And I'll tell you something, Romans is preached so out of context by people who always say, well, we've got to be in the context. It's unbelievable to me. It's astonishing to me how many people just cut off the first three chapters of Romans and preach the rest of it. The first three chapters of Romans get you really established on the simplicity and the universal offer of salvation. And then chapters, say, 4 through 8 really begin to move into God's purpose with the Jews. And man, people take those passages and they go all the way through really chapter 12. And they make the church and Israel one and the same. Instead of reconciling the two of them and understanding what God is doing, instead of understanding what the gospel is, they make Romans 8, Romans 9 the gospel. And boy, you can come out with some wacky doctrine with that. We want to just preach it in a way that you'll know it and understand it. I have a policy. That's when I send kids away to Christian college and they call me up and say, Pastor, I got some questions about Romans 9. I always tell them, well, I'd be happy to answer those questions, but I'd like you first to outline Romans. And it's amazing how a few times I've actually had them come back and tell me, well, Romans 1 through 3 covers this, Romans 4 through, they won't outline the book. They just want to talk about Romans 9, Romans 8, and they get caught up in the Calvinism that's taught. Well, Calvinism doesn't work in chapters 1 through 4, folks. And so one of the things we're going to do is preach all the way through so we understand everything in its context, and it'll help you have a good understanding. And you'll be more intelligent than most college students if you get it afterward. So, all right, I want to mention that to you. Here we are, John chapter 20. I preached last week's message last week, okay? Remember this? This is why Eddie's not here this morning. I was thinking, where's Eddie and Michelle today? Remember I said I'll see you all in 2 weeks? Last week they probably took me seriously. They're gone. So, anyway, Eddie asked me the question, what does it mean? What does Jesus mean when he says, feed my lambs? Well, let's read our passage here and then we'll answer that question today. In verse 15, the Bible says, so when they had dined, Jesus said to Seth, to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? He saith unto him, yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He saith unto him, feed my lambs. I want to go to the second part of verse 16. I don't want to read the whole verse. He saith unto him, Yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He saith unto him, Feed my sheep. The second part of verse 17. Lovest thou me? And he saith unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love thee. Jesus saith unto him, Feed my sheep. Verse 19. This spake he, signifying by what death he should glorify God. When he had spoken this, he saith unto him, Follow me. Well, we're going to pray and we're going to try to answer the question, what does it mean to feed my sheep and feed my lambs? I lost you guys.
Chapter 21, you mean?
So did I say 20?
Yes.
16.
Whatever you say, I said, I'm sure is right.
21. 21.
You know, has my wife been talking to you all about me lately? She should be. I keep telling her, you know, you ought to be concerned about me. I'm slipping. I'm losing it, you know. And she doesn't think it's any big. She says, oh, it's just because you're tired. I said, but I never slept any more than I do now, you know. And she's like, well, you're getting old, you know. I said, no, you know. But I'm telling you, I'm slipping. And so as long as I'm not dangerous, don't lock me up, okay? But, you know, as long as I'm trying to be a gentle person, so, you know, you don't have to worry about me.
You're only one chapter off.
You could turn me out. What'd you say?
You're only one chapter off.
That's close, isn't it? I mean, you should be able to just read your way down to where I was at, I would think. So, thank you for your graciousness, folks. You all are very kind to me, but I'm asking for more mercy. Don't put me in one of those institutions, please. So, this isn't an institution, is it?
No.
All right. It's okay to smile and laugh a little bit. Let's pray and we'll ask the Lord to help us. Should I read the scripture again? We need to start all over.
Double time.
We're going to read the statement, feed my lambs, verse 15. Now verse 16, feed my sheep. And now verse 17, feed my sheep. And now we'll pray. Father, please help us this morning. Lord, we don't want to be silly or foolish to the point that we would make light of spiritual truth or that we would overlook a very distinct command that you have given and that you gave to Peter. But Father, we want to understand the answer to the question that was asked last week. What does that mean to feed my sheep? And I pray that you would help us simply to comprehend it. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Well, John is one of how many Gospels?
Four.
Four, right? John is one of four Gospels and the only Gospel which doesn't have the explicit Great Commission in it. Isn't that interesting? Well, it isn't actually that interesting because it ought to answer the question what it means to feed my sheep. In other words, if Matthew said, well, let's read what Matthew said. Let's read the last words of Jesus in several of them. Matthew chapter 28. I said 28, okay? And I meant 28. Verse 19. Better read 18. Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, All power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I've commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Now, if you were to read verse 16, the Bible says the 11 disciples went away into Galilee into a mountain where Jesus had appointed them. Okay? So the instance we're talking about is actually the same instance we're talking about in John 21. Okay, let's go to Mark chapter 16. I said 16, and I hope I meant 16. Mark chapter 16, and verse 14. Afterward, he appeared unto the 11 as they sat at meat, and upbraided them with their unbelief and hardness of heart, because they believed not them which had seen him after he was risen. And he said unto them, Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. And we see the signs afterward in verse 19. After the Lord had spoken, he was received up into heaven and sat on the right hand of God. Okay, Luke and chapter 20, I think it's 24. Luke 24. I said 24, I meant 24. Good when I qualify what I mean. I get right more often. verse 44. And he said unto them, these are the words which I spake unto you while I was yet with you, that all things must be fulfilled which were written in the law of Moses and in the prophets and in the Psalms concerning me. Then opened he their understanding, that they might understand the Scriptures. And he said unto them, thus it is written, and thus it behooved Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead the third day. Verse 47, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. And ye are witnesses of these things, and behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you. But tarry ye into the city of Jerusalem until ye be endued with power from on high. That's where we pick up in Acts, on Luke's account. Okay? Now, last week we were in John chapter 21, and as we were preaching in John, one of the things we were looking at was that question that Jesus asked Peter. And the question specifically that Jesus asked Peter was, lovest thou me more than these? In other words, Peter, do you love me more than everyone else here loves me? That's the question. Now, I've had people say, well, you know, it could be that, you know, do you love him more than you love the land that's around you? Or do you love him more than you love fishing that's here? No, the only reason Peter went fishing was because that was his occupation, but he was a disciple of the Lord Jesus. He left his fishing, but when Jesus wasn't with him, Peter didn't know what to do. Why is that? Well, because Peter had not yet been filled with the power of the Holy Ghost. He had not been endued with power, which is what happened when he waited at Jerusalem and received the promise of the Father. The disciples knew what they were supposed to do when they were filled with the Spirit. But they didn't know what to do before they were filled with the Spirit, so they went fishing because that's what they knew how to do. Well, Jesus showed up, and Jesus, though, in chapter 21 of John, is referring back to a statement, a conversation that he had with Peter 2 days before he was crucified, when he was ready, the night he was taken, to go to the cross. And he said, I'm going to die. And he said, folks are going to deny me. And Peter had vehemently promised Jesus in John 13, he said, oh, if everyone denies me, if all of these, Jesus, deny you, all the other disciples deny you, I won't deny you, Jesus. I'll stand with you, I'll stand by you, and I won't deny you. And Jesus said, Peter, I'm telling you, by the time the cock crows in the morning, you will have denied me 3 times. Now, I know that's my summary, but that's the story. That's what happened. So, you'll deny me 3 times by morning time. And Peter is just aghast. He's taken aback. And, I mean, he's the guy that had the sword in the garden when Judas came and betrayed Jesus with a kiss. And Peter's the one that... Was it Malchus? No, what's the name of the boy that got his ear chucked? Was it Malchus? He got his ear wet? What was his name? Malchus. Okay, his name was Malchus. Hey, Randy, good to see you, brother. Glad you're back. Anyway, so whacked off his ear with a sword. Peter had the courage to fight for Jesus, but he did not possess the courage when it came down to identifying with the Lord Jesus. If you were to ask Peter the night that Jesus said, in the morning, you'll betray me 3 times, if you'd ask him who was most loyal to Peter or to Jesus and who would never betray Jesus no matter what, Peter would have said me. There's no one that loves Jesus more than I do. There's no one more loyal to Jesus than I am. And that very night, he denied Jesus 3 times. Peter has since seen the resurrected Savior. He's seen the empty tomb. He knows Jesus is alive. But Jesus appeared to him several times, but they didn't have, when Jesus was resurrected, they didn't follow him for those 40 days. So he appeared to him several times. When Jesus wasn't there, what was Peter to do? When Jesus was there, who provided for their food? Jesus. When Jesus was there, who decided where they would go?
Jesus.
I know it's kind of common sense, but it's good for us to think it through. Disciples follow the Master. Disciples do whatever the Master does. They don't have to be concerned about their provision. They don't have to be concerned about where they'll go, what they'll do, how they'll do it. They just do what the Master says. So they're without direction when Jesus isn't with them. They've received the Holy Ghost, but they're not empowered by the Holy Spirit. And so they went fishing. And when they were out fishing, of course, they saw someone on the seashore. This is the first encounter with Simon. It was this fishing experience. Remember this? He'd already believed in Jesus, but Jesus came down to the seashore where he and his brother were fishing. Jesus said, hey, cast the net on the other side. And they weren't able to draw up the net because of all the fish. They had to call their friends and, you know, and in order to bring all the fish into shore. They probably lost a lot of fish. They had so many of them. And then here they fished all night, and Jesus calls out, "Children, have you any meat?" They answered him, "None." You know, it's like somebody's, "Hey guys, you got any fish?" You want to buy them all fresh off the dock or something. And no, we don't have any. He said, "Try to put the net on the other side." Oh boy, we've done this before. They couldn't bring them in. Peter jumped in the water and swam home. Went back to Jesus. And Jesus already had meat on the fire. He had fish on the fire. It was breakfast time. This is just a great moment, isn't it? Jesus, this is right. This is how we met. This is the way it was back before we started following you. And now that you're alive and resurrected from the dead, you know, here we are again. And then Jesus ruined the whole moment by asking Peter, "Do you love me?" Before he went to the cross, Peter said, "I'll die for you, Jesus. Why can't we go with you? If you're going to die, I'll die right when you die. We'll both die." Why wasn't Peter denied Jesus? He was afraid for his life. I mean, literally here, Jesus is in the house of the high priest, and John knew somebody there and got him in, and they're at the fire, and this little maid says, "You're one of his followers." And he was scared of her. He was afraid of her. And he denied Jesus so much that in a few moments, he started cursing. And he went out weeping bitterly. Now things are better. Jesus is back from the dead. Fishing's good. And Jesus has to ask the question, "Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me?" How's Peter supposed to answer that question? The last time he told Jesus he loved him, Jesus said, "You'll deny me," and he did. See, before, Peter was comparing himself with the other disciples. He said, "If all these guys deny you, I won't. I love you more than anybody else." And Peter said, "Simon, do you love me more than they do?" How are you going to answer that question? You know how you answer the question? Just answer it. "Yes, Lord, I love you." Christian, I want to remind us about something. It is not in us. It is not in us to be faithful to God or to love God. It is in God to be faithful to us and for us to love Him in response. Our ability to love God, I'm just telling you something, we just love ourselves so much that the moment we get in our flesh, we'll deny Him. That's the reality. You want to depend on your flesh. Before that, Peter said, "You know something, I'll die." Turned out that wasn't so. When it came down to dying, Peter wouldn't do it. But Peter did it. And that's what Jesus concluded his conversation with Peter. The Bible said, "You know, when you were young," he said, "people carried you, they girt you. When you're old, they're going to do the same thing. They're going to tie you up and you're going to go where you wouldn't go, where you don't want to go." And I wouldn't understand that, but the Scripture explains, and it says, "This said he," signifying by what death he would die. In other words, explaining, "Peter, you're going to be put to death for me." And Peter immediately asked, "Well, what about John? How's he going to die?" And Jesus said, "What is that to thee?" What else did he say? "Till he come, what is that to thee?" And then what did he say?
Follow me.
And before he said, "Follow me," what did he say? "Feed my lambs, feed my sheep." That's what I want to focus on today, Christian. I want us to understand something, first of all, and I want to state it so that it's as simply understood as possible. Living for Jesus is not hard, my friend. Living for Jesus is not difficult. It's not complicated. It isn't a matter of, okay, I need to solve the puzzle. I need to find a clue that shows me how that I can go through the maze of life, changing direction constantly, continually, and ultimately end up figuring out what God's plan for my life is and coming out the other side. My friend, life isn't a puzzle. Life isn't a maze. It really comes down to two words: follow me. And those two words are explained by three words: feed my sheep. Do you know what the apostles did? Do you realize what Peter did after Jesus ascended? Have you ever think about it? I mean, right on the next page in your Bible, what's in my Bible next page, is Acts chapter 1. And it begins to explain the acts of the apostles, the acts of the Holy Spirit, the acts of the apostles through the power of the Holy Spirit, and explains where the church came from. Acts is church history. Do you realize that in the Old Testament times, they didn't have the church? It wasn't the church that God was working in and through. He was working through Israel. Do you realize that? Who came up with the idea of the church? Jesus did. Who implemented it, practically speaking? The disciples did. They were the apostles. Was Peter smart enough to establish a church? I'm not picking on Peter. Let me ask you a question. Are you smart enough? I shouldn't ask that, but I'm going to be picking on you. Okay. Was Peter smart enough to establish the church? Never seen one before, didn't know what one was, didn't have a clue. How in the world did he do it? He followed Jesus and he fed his sheep. That's how he did it, and then the Holy Spirit empowered him to do it.
And then he was the first pope.
Thank you, Tony. Appreciate that. You know, it's ironic, and I don't want to be mean-spirited about anything I say today. I don't need to. I don't want to, and I shouldn't. You know, but it is ironic how that the organization builds up Peter as though he's something. As though, you know, he is the first pope, as though Peter is, you know, the vicar for Christ or something. You know what Peter was? He was a disciple that betrayed the Lord Jesus and didn't have a clue what Jesus was saying when he's saying, "Feed my sheep." And yet, he's the same guy that a matter of a few short months later stands up in Jerusalem and boldly proclaims Christ to the very people who were responsible for crying, "Crucify him." The very people he was afraid would kill him, Peter stood up and proclaimed the gospel, and literally that day, multitudes were added to Christ's church. Do you think Peter had the intelligence to figure out how to turn events like that? Not on your life. Not hardly. But what Peter did have, my friend, is a very simple grasp and understanding of the last words of Jesus Christ. And that's really what we're going to look at this morning. We're going to look first of all at this statement, "Feed my sheep." As I mentioned a moment ago, John is the only gospel writer that doesn't end by explaining the Great Commission. And it isn't because John doesn't preach the Great Commission. It's because John explains the Great Commission in the exact words of the Lord Jesus here when he says, "Feed my sheep." So last week, at the end of the message, Eddie raised his hand and he just blew my cover. I mean, ruined my message for this entire week. He said, "Pastor, when Jesus said, 'Feed my sheep,' is he talking about the disciples of Jesus being fed, or is he talking about the lost?" So let's go to Matthew's explanation of the Great Commission, because I think it's the best as far as being concise. Let's don't use the term best. It fits what we're talking about this morning very well. All of the Great Commission, the scriptures equally weighty and powerful, and all scripture is given by inspiration of God. But Matthew is, if you're going to memorize what the Great Commission is, it's very clear, it's very concise. Matthew chapter 28 again, and verse 19. Jesus said, "Go ye therefore and teach all nations." Okay, let me ask you a question. If we're going to answer the question about who are the sheep that are supposed to be fed, and Jesus said, "Go and teach all nations," would the sheep in that description be saved or lost?
Everyone.
Yeah, well, are they saved or lost? That's the two choices.
Saved.
They're not saved.
Lost.
They're lost, right? Are all the nations saved today?
No.
Teach them what? We'll teach them about the what Jesus explained previous to this. Explained that the Scripture must needs be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet Moses and by the law and by the prophets. That Christ needed to die and be buried and be risen from the dead. And that as a result of it, all power would be given to Christ's church. And Jesus told his disciples, "Go ye therefore and teach all nations." So the question, when Jesus said, "Feed my sheep," And when Matthew said, Jesus said, go and teach all nations, they're talking about the same event. You understand this? They're talking about the same time, the same commands that Jesus gave. John said, Jesus said, feed my sheep, and he did. Matthew said, Jesus said, go ye therefore and teach all nations, and he did. And friend, I would have to say to you on the authority of the Scripture that what Jesus meant when he said, feed my sheep, is to go and teach all nations. Okay, then the second part of Matthew 28:19, though, is baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things. Now let me ask you a question. Saved or lost?
Saved.
Saved. In other words, these are individuals who have received Jesus Christ every sin and have consequently received the power to become the sons of God. They're saved. So who are Jesus' sheep? The lost and then the saved. The lost and the saved. And so that was the question Eddie asked last week and what I wanted to preach about this week. And I want to look at just one last key. We've been emphasizing this for several weeks, but I hope we get this, folks. I just really hope we do. Let's go to Acts chapter 1 now, and we'll draw the conclusion from Luke's account of Jesus' last words. You can't explain this enough. You can't look at it enough. You can't emphasize enough what God is doing. Luke, if you were to finish, by the way, when you read Acts, if you have the time, the best way to read Acts is to read the Gospel of Luke and then just read right into Acts. It's a seamless transition. The address in both letters is to Theophilus. Theophilus is it's a mixture of two words. And we don't know whether it was a person, or we don't know whether it was a reference to any person who fits the description. Theos, God. Philos is love. Love of God. One who loves God. So Theophilus may have been a person who literally was named Theophilus, and we're implied that he loves God, but I like the second application of it better. I would like to call myself Theophilus. I think Theophilus would be a great nickname for somebody, wouldn't it? I mean, if I could call myself something that would stick, Theophilus. What a great name. You call me Theo for short. No, don't call me that. Call me Philos, for Philo for short or something, because you couldn't call me God for short. But I would want to be described. Wouldn't you want to be described if your life were known, you were going to write your epitaph, the one who loves God? I mean, what an epitaph. What a way to live. I mean, any person could live for that. And so that's what the address is. The former treatise have I made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began to do and to teach until the day in which he was taken up. After that, he, through the Scripture, had given commandments, or after that, he, through the Holy Ghost, had given commandments unto the apostles whom he had chosen. So Jesus gave his last words to his apostles before he ascended. And then the Bible says, to whom also he showed himself alive after his passion, speaking of the events of the cross, the death, the burial, and the resurrection, being seen of them 40 days, and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. I mentioned this in Sunday school, and I think it's ironic that Jesus for 40 days spent that time talking about the kingdom. And then they asked him in verse 6, when they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel? So for 40 days he talked to them about the kingdom. For 40 days they were thinking about the kingdom, and then they said, okay, is it time for the kingdom? And he said unto them, verse 7, it is not for you to know the times or seasons which the Father hath placed, has put in his own power. And I love this because it's really helpful. It's good for being introspective, and it's good to understand what's going on, because people blah, blah, blah about the kingdom today, don't they? Probably blah, blah, blah. It's not nice words, but I used them. We'll stand by them. Don't you hear people talk about the kingdom? We're building Christ's kingdom. We're all in his kingdom. Kingdom, 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 kingdom. It's kingdom theology. And it's interesting that when Jesus Christ, before he ascended to heaven, talked to the disciples about the kingdom, and they said, is it time for the kingdom? And Jesus said, no, none your business. In other words, that's not what's going on right now. Right now we're in the church age, folks. It's the church Jesus is working through. And I'm telling you something, you ought to be a church-loving nut job. Nut job is probably not the right word for it. But I mean, you ought to be just crazy about the church. Jesus is all about his church. He's given himself for it, and he's died for it. And everybody's trying to build a kingdom. And Jesus isn't trying to build a kingdom. He's trying to build his church. And the way that he has prescribed for the church to build is that the disciples are going to receive the power of the Holy Ghost, and they're going to be witnesses to all nations, and they're going to baptize and teach people about the church. Teach them to observe all things. What are they supposed to observe? Kingdom theology? Boy, Galatians kind of puts that to rest, doesn't it? When they try to Judaize believers, Acts 15 kind of puts that to rest, doesn't it? When they start telling them, hey, you got to be circumcised and you got to keep the law and you got this, that's kingdom, my friend. That's kingdom theology. But Jesus said, what you're all about is teaching all nations. What you're all about is baptizing them. What you're all about is teaching them to observe all things. What things? Well, the things we got in the New Covenant of the Scripture, the New Testament. Don't misunderstand me. Don't think that somehow I'm discounting the first covenant of the Scripture. But friend, we need to understand the difference between Israel and the church. We need to understand the difference between what God is doing today and what God will do when the Holy Spirit no longer is letting or withholding while He still is among us. So many Christians are so confused about what God's trying to do. We're trying to build up something. We've got better ideas than God does. And I'm not talking about the cults. I'm talking about Christians. You know, the Jehovah's Witnesses try to say we're in the kingdom right now. And I don't want to be mean about it, but that's laughable, isn't it? I mean, it's really comical that God's doing this. You're going to blame a holy, just, perfect God? Oh, this is God's kingdom. No, no, my friend, this is not God's kingdom. When Jesus Christ rules and reigns, there are going to be things that are happening that couldn't happen. A lion can lay down with a lamb when Jesus is in charge. I was going to refer to that incident in Orlando last week, but I think it would be in bad taste. I was just going to say that, you know, that alligator and that baby wouldn't have had a problem if Jesus was ruling and reigning. And I hope that you wouldn't misunderstand that or take that in a way that would be crude at all. But this world's not perfect, my friend. It is controlled by, it is marred by sin, and the answer for it, and Jesus' response to the world problems, is that we are to feed His sheep and that we are to follow Him. And all boiled down, that makes life pretty simple. Let's review. Jesus told Peter, He said, feed my sheep. He said, follow me. In the Great Commission, He said, ye shall receive power. And friend, it really comes down to that. Here's how we do it. First of all, you have to have received Jesus as your Savior. Here this morning, you have to know that Jesus is the only way. Right after Jesus told Peter that He would deny Him, in John chapter 14, verse 1, He said, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, you believe also in Me. And then right after that, in John 14, 6, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by Me. If you're here this morning, friend, and you haven't received Jesus as the only way, hey, listen, you may be trying to be a good church person, good denominational person. You may be here this morning, and it might be that you're religious, and you're just trying to keep the law and be a good follower of God. I just want to tell you something. That isn't how a person becomes part of Christ's church. You become part of Christ's church, my friend, by understanding what Jesus said. I'm the way, the truth, and life. No man cometh unto the Father but by Me. You go to God through Jesus. And you do that by receiving what Jesus did when He died on the cross for our sin, was buried, and rose again. And that's how you have new life in Jesus. That's the foundation. You're not going to be fitting into what Christ is doing, into what Jesus is accomplishing. You're not going to be able to follow Jesus without receiving Jesus. You've got to be God's child, God's son. The Bible says, as many as received Him, to them gave He the power to become the sons of God, even as many as believe on His name. And friend, you have to believe on the name of Jesus Christ. The Bible makes the gospel very, very simple. It's amazing. Even in the Scriptures that go through great discourses explaining the law and grace and all these things, it always comes down to the believing of faith. I mean, it just comes, hey, received you Christ by the works of the law, by the believing of the faith. Even the Jews who knew all the law couldn't be saved or justified by the law. They just had to believe by faith. And that's how simple it is to have Jesus as your Savior. Do you know Jesus? Do you have Jesus Christ? Have you received Jesus? Have you been saved? And then, have you followed the teachings of Jesus? Have you been baptized as the Scripture teaches you ought to? Are you observing what Christ is doing? Are you living for it? Because Jesus said, follow Me. Then it gets really, really super simple from there on. After that, Christian, you need to be filled with the Holy Spirit. When you get saved, you're sealed by the Spirit. And you are sealed literally until the day that you leave this earth, leave this world, whether by Christ coming or whether by physically your body dying and you getting a temporary body, being temporarily clothed by a body when you're absent from the body and present with the Lord Jesus Christ. Permanent. You cannot lose your salvation. It is eternal. So friend, the question is, have you received Jesus? And when we talk about being filled with the Spirit, do you understand there's a difference between being sealed and being filled? Jesus told the disciples, you're going to be filled, you're going to be empowered. That's a thing of the past, my friend. You don't have to wait to receive the promise of the Father. We've received it. The Holy Spirit is in the world, my friend. He's here. The only thing limiting the works of the Holy Spirit are really two basic concepts. Either he is grieved or he's quenched. But if you pray and say, God, fill me with your Spirit, you'll be able to feed his sheep. You'll be able to feed his lambs. And you'll be able to follow Jesus. And practically speaking, I think it is important for us to ask that question. I want to preach a message and say, do you love Jesus? Would you say that you love Jesus more than anyone else? Listen, you ought to. You shouldn't be ashamed to say, I love Jesus more than everybody in this room. At least in your heart, you ought to believe that's so. And it ought to be that it's so because you know how much Jesus loves you and because you love him back. You shouldn't say, well, I don't want to compare myself to anybody. But yes, I do love you more than all these. Jesus, I love you with all my heart. Jesus, that's a command. We're supposed to love God with all our heart, all our soul, and all our mind. So should you answer that question the way Peter did? Yes. Jesus asks you again, and he responds, though. His response to Peter was, well, if you love me, feed my sheep. If you love me, feed my lambs. And practically speaking, friend, it's kind of a lie if we say we love Jesus, but we don't follow him. Peter did. Peter didn't die for Jesus to earn his eternal life. He just died for Jesus because he loved him. He died for Jesus because he fed his sheep, he fed his lambs, and he got a greater sense of the whole picture than he had the day that he said, if everyone else denies you, I won't. I'll die for you, Jesus. Oh, those were bold, brash words on the part of Peter, but they were nothing compared to what Peter was after the Holy Spirit had empowered him and he got a picture of what God was doing. He got a taste of what it was to preach the gospel, to see people come to Christ and to baptize them and to teach them to observe all things. Man, by the time Peter wrote those letters, first the ones we have in our scripture, 1st and 2nd Peter, he was a different guy, wasn't he? Different man altogether. Now, he was a great guy before that. I think he was one of the best of the disciples. But I'm telling you, by the time Peter died for Jesus, he was a different man. You know, you may be here this morning, you say, Pastor, I don't know if I could... I mean, you're talking about dying here. I don't know if I could say how much I love Jesus. Well, my friend, I'll tell you what you do. You may not know how much you love Jesus, but you'll find out if you follow him. You don't know if you have the courage to die for Jesus, but you know if you are filled with the Holy Spirit. You don't know if you love Jesus, but you'd know if you were teaching people, if you're feeding his sheep. Things would be different if you went to that level. You know, a lot of us, we have a self-serving Christianity. We talk about, oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me, and I love me too. And that's kind of the way we do it. We love ourselves. You know, Jesus, when Paul was writing the church at Ephesus and describing the relationship of a husband and wife and submission, one of the things he said was that husbands are to love their wives as Christ loved the church. And then Jesus qualified that by saying, no man ever yet hated his own flesh, but nourisheth and cherisheth it. And we do love ourselves. Friend, the only way to get over that self-love that'll lead you to betrayal even of your Savior, the only way to get over it is to follow him and to feed his sheep. You say, Pastor, you know what? I have a problem. I have a problem with selfishness. I have a problem with self-love. You know what? I'm more loyal to me than I am to God. I'm sad to say that I've observed that in Christianity. Christians are more loyal to themselves than they are to their Savior. The only way to get over that, my friend, is to just be filled with the Spirit of God and follow him and feed his sheep. And living for Jesus isn't so hard, isn't so complicated that anyone couldn't do it. Anyone could do it, even Peter, and even me, and even you. Father, I pray that you would help us to further understand, God, not from from so much study and not so much from comprehension, but help us to understand from the doing of it what it means to be filled and to be feeding your sheep. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to have a time of invitation in our service this morning. I want to explain the invitation for two things. First of all, if you're not familiar with the invitation is just what the word means. It's a time when we invite you, if God has spoken to you, to respond to what He said. In other words, if I invite you to dinner today and you don't give me an answer, I don't know whether you'll show up. I wish I could invite you. I could invite you to church at Miami Beach in a little while, but not dinner. We don't have time for that. But if I could invite you and you didn't answer me about whether or not you're coming, that would be a little strange, wouldn't it? Because how would I know whether to expect you or not? When God's Word is preached and God's Spirit puts His finger on something in your heart and says, oh, you ought to add that to your faith. That ought to be added to your comprehension, your understanding about God. Or, oh, that's wrong in your life. That's sin. Or you're thinking wrong. Or you're sinning. Or you're doing something wrong. When God does that, He's spoken to you. And it would be appropriate for you to respond. And that's why we have an invitation. It's not so you can come forward in the church and be seen by people. It's so that you can have a moment to make sure that you say, yes, Lord. And that really is what the invitation is about. Now, if you're here this morning and you don't have the matter of salvation settled, you don't know that you've said, yes, Lord, to the free gift of eternal life and you've received Jesus as your Savior, that's what the invitation is for. I've got men in our service, and we don't have our piano player right now, but I've got men in our service. If you're a man that could open a scripture, open the scriptures and show you how to know you have eternal life. I have ladies that could do the same thing if you're here this morning. And you're ladies, as far as I know, everyone that I know here has received Jesus. If you have not, that's the invitation for you to say, yes, Lord, to receiving the free gift of eternal life. The second part of the invitation, I don't mean to belabor it, but it's important for us to understand, is for us to say, yes, Lord, to truth that God shared with us, that God showed us. And friend, it's simple truth today. It isn't hard to understand. It's just a matter of doing it. It might be that if you said, yes, Lord, it might be that that would mean you'd come to visitation tomorrow night at 6:30. That would be a practical way of putting it, wouldn't it? If you were to say, okay, I'm going to feed his sheep, well, then I don't know how to do that. Well, you could just do it the way that the church is doing it. You could go in and share the gospel. You could be a witness at work. Whatever God showed you, you could say, yes, Lord, too. Does everybody understand the invitation? You don't need to come forward unless you want someone to pray with you. I'd be happy to do that. But you could do business with God right where you're at. And that's what we want. We don't want to count numbers. We don't want to say, hey, we had this many people respond to the invitation. We want you to do business with God. And that's why we take the time. We're at page 242. If you're physically able to do so, it would be helpful if you could stand.